My name is Allegra Tevet. And before the war, I was a young girl. I was a family. I had my mother and father, and we were 7 children in the family. I have 4 sisters and 3 brothers with myself. And very happy family. I was living in Drama, Greece, which is north of Greece. They call it Macedonia. It's close to Salonika. And I went to a Jewish school. They call it the School of Alliance, which was, I learned the Hebrew and the Greek and the French. And I had a wonderful, happy life. My father was a shoemaker. My mother was at home raising the family. And I lived a very, very happy life until the war broke out. When the war broke in 1940, there was with the Italians in Albania, which is in Italy. And the Italians, they was ruling Albania at that time, and they broke the war. And then in 1941, Hitler came to, the Germans came to Greece through Italy. Italy gave the pass, we lost the war, and Italy gave the pass to the Germans, and the Germans captured all the Jewish people in Greece. And I was living in Drama that time, and then we came the war with the Bulgarian, which is north of Greece. We are in the border of Bulgarian. And they came in a week. My mother says we can't live in Drama because the Bulgarians, they are so barbarian, you know, they really kind of, they take the people from the homes, especially young girls and boys, they kill them. They do a lot of bad things. And so my sister was married, the oldest one, and was living in Salonika. So we took false identifications, and we went to Salonika. And Salonika, when I went, the Germans was there. They already put at the Star of David, the yellow Star of David, and they tried to not to go to the main streets like Broadway, all the main streets, not to go to the transportation, the trains, they are. So they're starting to forbid the Jewish people to have communication in the busy streets. So we came, the whole family was in Salonika. In 1941, we was in Salonika. In 1942, they took us, it was in August, they took us, they put us in a ghetto.
Can you tell us what life in the ghetto was like for you?
The ghetto, it was terrible. I cannot express with the words. In one room to live, you know, a bread, just a piece of bread, like 4 ounces of bread they give you, a little soup, like a cabbage soup. You know, it was a hard time, very hard time. Still, I was preferring to be in the ghetto and then at the camp. A lot of times, we try to escape from the ghetto, they'll catch you. We don't starve, but my father tried to escape from the ghetto, and they catch him, they took it back. They kick him, they beat him. It was a terrible. But before I said the ghetto, I can tell you that when in Salonika we was, you see, you Jew, they shoot you. And the sidewalks, there was people dead, a lot of people. Young kids, older people, older ladies, young women. If they see you, you know, for nothing, just they kill like a bird, they kill them. And people with starvation, no food to eat. And it was hard, hard, very hard. But at the ghetto, it was kind of, how can I tell you? It was a terrible experience, to come from a family, happy home, into big house, and to be in one room, and to share bathrooms, excuse me, with other people and everything. It was a hard, and it was depressing. A lot of people, they died just from depression, for the starvation. They died a lot of people before they took them to Birkenau.
Were you able to celebrate holidays or go to school in the ghetto? What was the daily life?
Nothing, no. After German occupied Greece, nothing we can do. All the synagogues was destroyed. The Jewish store was, they took position, the Greek people, not the Jewish, the Greek people, the Gentile. And it was a terrible experience. In March of 43, they took us to Birkenau. They took us in trains. We stayed almost for a week in the trains. The trains was like they put the animals, not even the animals, they are like this, with a small little window with the bars. And over there, you starve to death. You put a blanket in one cone and you do go to bathroom over there, and a lot of people die inside the wagons. The smell, the starvation, the hard time. So, and when we say for water, they put the hose, they stop the train and they put the hose, and the water, they spray, everybody open the mouth like this for to get water in the mouth. Just with the hose, it was sprayed to us. And then we arrive in Birkenau. When we arrive in Birkenau, they divided the separation, the women and the men, and the young and the old. And if you carry a child, you go with old people. And so I went with my two sisters. My other sister, she was carrying the little boy, 5-year-old. So she went with my mother. My brother Joseph, he was 11 years old. He went with my mother. My father separate, and my two brothers went separate. One of my brother was 15, and the other one was 16 and a half. Henri, Aaron, and Menachem, and Yosef went with my father, with my mother. And my sister Matilda, and my sister Julia, the one I survived with her, and I, we went three together. So we went, and then they took us, we walked to Birkenau, and walking a lot. And they took us over there, and then first of all, they would take all the clothes, they shave us, all the hair, and we went to take a shower. Took shower, and they give us clothes, like prisoner clothes. They put a tattoo here, the number. My number is 39028. They put the number, and we took a shower, and we dress up clothes, prisoner clothes, and over here they put the number of the... And then we stay over there on the changing, and then another group, you know, the groups and groups are taken, but 50, 60 people take a shower, see? And there was so depressed at the beginning to see how we was treated like a animals. We never thought that's going to happen that way. But and then they took us, they put us in a quarantine in barracks. When they took us to the barrack over there, we have to be for 40 days quarantine. We can't go out, only to take us out to they call him Chelapel, you means to count to us, you know. And they count, and when they call you up, they call you by the number, they don't call you by name. And so the next day over there was everything. Over there, bathroom, no bathrooms. It was a big barrels of iron, very heavy. Over there you go and you have bathroom. And then the next day, she wants to take those barrels and throw to the bathroom to go outside of the barrack. So, and I was very courage, I should say. I want to know what's happening, when I'm going to see my mother. So I went out with the four other girls. They got handles in their barrels. Two girls in one side, two girls on the other side. We carried the barrels to go to bathrooms. And the bathroom was a big barrack. And they had the holes in wood you do over there. And we take those barrels in to throw in. We saw a lot of girls over there, German Jews, French girls. And we told, when can we see our mothers? And you know what he said? He said, did you see that chimney over there, that smoke? Over there, they are our mothers. Don't you know, he says? All the mothers, they are in they burn them up. So the next day, when we went back to the barrack, we start screaming and say that what happened to our parents and everything. So for 40 days, I was going back and forth, carrying the barrels of the bathroom, going to the canteen to carry the barrels of soup, you know, and to give me a piece of a little extra soup so I can give to my sisters extra. And then they took us to work as a house commando. House commando is outside in the rain, in the snow, you know, just to break, like, you know, those telephone poles, the big ones. They used to have handles, and we used to push them to break the walls. So the walls was a brick, and then we take the bricks and we clean the cement out. So that's what we did almost until 1940, the end of 43. After that, we took us to Auschwitz. We used to work from Birkenau, we used to work to Auschwitz. Back and forth, we used to walk, see? And if you do something wrong, or you can't walk fast, they shoot you. There was ditches on the side, and they throw them. And if they don't throw, they let you do the throwing. You know what I mean? You to pick him up, the dead person, and throw him in the ditch. So we really kind of, I was working back and forth, Birkenau and Auschwitz. And from Auschwitz, and then they said they want a shoe commando. The shoes from the transport they was bringing so many people. We have to take the shoes and clean the leather separate and the salt separate, to tear them up, everything, you know, and they send them to the factories in Germany. My sister Matilda, she was very depressed, and she was not reading enough. and I was working in the shoe commando, and I was having an extra piece of bread, and then I was a friserka. Friserka means a beauty operator. And I used to go, and the German, there was a lot of Germans, prisoners over there, non-Jewish, and Ukrainian, non-Jewish, Russian. They used to get packages from their own country. And I used to go, and they used to call me to go to cut their hair, to fix their hair nice, and they used to give me a piece of extra bread, or their cookie, whatever it is. And then there was a block spare in the evening. After I come from work, I used to go and do those to give me a piece of bread extra. And then in the night, 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock is a block spare. Block spare is curfew. And I used to, I never walk. I used to do like the snake walks, you know, the ground. And I used to bring for a piece of bread so I can give to my sister because she was so depressed. And she don't make it. And I used to work, and my sister, the one is in Israel, she used to work. But the other one, Matilda, she never worked. She was so depressed, she don't have the energy. She was skin and bone. So one time they made a big selection, they took her. She escaped. The second time, she can escape. There was a big selection. Selection means, you know, it's if they see you a little bruise, if they see you a little scratch on your body, you're not good enough for work. You are good enough to go to crematorium. And if you, the bones, they see you, the bones come out from your skin, you are entitled to go to crematorium. So that's what happened to my sister. I was working in the in a commando that to clean the bricks with my sister Julia, the one she lives in Israel. And I saw my two brothers, Henri and Menachem, and I saw them. They're so handsome. Oh, he was so handsome, tall young man. And he saw me, he saw my sister, and he say, "Where is Matika? Matilda?" I said, "They took Matilda." I said, "Henri, you hungry? I'm gonna pour underneath the tree my bread. Please take it, you and Mimi, share it." And then my sister Julia said, "I'll give my bread to me." So we give our portion of bread to my brothers. I saw two times him. He was carrying the bricks in a carriage, and the boys was the horses to pull the carriage, you know. And when I saw that, break my heart. And that two times I saw them, my brothers, and I never saw more. From Auschwitz, they took us from there, and we walk in the snow, walking in the snow. They give us some shoes with the wood, heavy. If you don't walk fast, they shoot you. They don't have nothing for to shoot. They shoot you like a bird. Anyway, so they took us from there. We walk one day, and in the night, they put us in a barn where the horses, the animals stay. We sit down over there in the hay for the night. In the morning, they give us the soup. And we went in a train, open train. And I was so thirsty when I was walking. And I bent that I took a little snow to put in my mouth, you know. So, and for a whole day, walking. And then the train was so open in the rain and the snow, so they took us over there at the Bergen-Belsen. Over there was in 1945, you know, in the winter over there, you know, you can, you don't work so hard. You work, of course, but you don't work so hard like you used to work. You work in the house commando, digging things, you know, throwing the dogs. And the girls, they want to go to bathroom, and they are a German soldier in the door to guard you. You can't stay 5 seconds over there. If you stay 5 seconds, you come out, they shoot you. And I saw people in the ditches, dead, no clothes. One morning, the soldier, he told me, "Klein, why are you crying?" I said, "But I'm crying, my mother kaput, my father kaput, my sister, my brothers, all kaput, did she?" I told him. He say, "You go home. You're going to go home," he says. "I'm kaput." And the next day, in the morning, we saw no more work. And then a week after, we went out, and the girls were screaming and yelling and clapping and singing. I said, "What happened?" And we saw white flags. There was... give up, or how can I say? Surrendered. They were surrendered, the Germans. And we saw some big commander Germans in the tanks with the English soldiers. And we start throwing rocks to the Germans, you know. And that was the liberation. And some girls, they never saw the liberation because they die as soon as they hear. As soon as they hear we are free, they die. A lot of girls. From starvation, from the excitement, from, I don't know, what can I say, you know? And then they came, the English, and they took us to better dormitories. They give us clean clothes. They give us beds. And it's a dormitory, and then they give us food, and a lot of people, they eat right away the food, and you know, when your stomach is so empty and you eat the heavy food, you get sick, you die. The liberation for me, it was happy and sad. I should say first sad, because I lost everybody. And then I saw some people from Greece. I said, "Well, is my brothers alive?" No, they took him, the crematoria. I don't believe it. I still now, it seems to me like I'm gonna hear my brother's voice gonna say, "Allegra, I'm alive." I can't believe that my brothers, I can't believe until now that my brothers are dead. It's impossible. There was fighters, young boys. And then from there, we was a little bit, they came, the Red Cross, they came, a lot of big organizations to talk to us, the prisoners. I should not say the survivors. But we was prisoners anyway. They talked to the survivors, and they want to know if we have relatives in overseas. And I knew that from Greece, I was in Salonika, but I have a lot of relatives in Drama, where I was born. I have my father's brothers, my sisters, my father's sisters. I have my mother's brother and another city, which was Macedonia, all those, they took them. Nobody survived from those people. After the liberation, I went to Athens. That we went, they took us from one place to another to recuperate it. It took up in the mountains in a Swedish place. In the mountains, we stayed in tents over there. After there, we went by buses. By bus, we went to Brussels. They took us to Brussels. And then in Brussels, we stayed over there almost a month. We had a beautiful place over there. It's like a dormitory, you know, big place. The Red Cross and the English took care of everything of us. They give us clothes, nice food to eat, everyday showers. And from there, from Brussels, we flew to Greece in a cargo plane. And we went with the English plane, British. And I went back to Greece. And I would not believe from nobody told me that my brother was dead. I said to my sister, we're going to go to Greece. But the Red Cross said to me, you want to go to Israel? You want to go to America? You want to go to Paris? You want to go to England? Wherever you want to go, we'll take you. And I said, I want to go to Greece. Well, I went back to Greece, and at the Jewish Community Center, it was a big list for the survivors. And my cousins, my father's niece, two nieces, and nephew, was in Athens. They hide in the mountains. And they saw the list of my name and my sister's name. And they saw, and they came to the airport over there. They already knew what the day we gonna arrive. And we came to Athens. And I remember very well, it was a week before Rosh Hashanah. We went over there in 1945. So I went to Athens, and I stayed over my cousins, and they told me that Albert Tevet is alive. He survived. He was at the camp. He left drama, and he went back to Salon. He came to Salonika. He escaped from the ghetto twice, my husband, and twice they got him. He gives some money to Greek people to save him, and he says, I can't afford to destroy Greece from one Jew. That's, I was anti-Semitic Greek. And my husband was captured and took him to concentration camp. So when my sister Lisa told me that Albert Tevet is alive too, and I knew him from my hometown, I went back to drama, and I'm engaged. In 2 weeks, I was married. And I had a very happy life. I have a happy life until, but there was a lot of antisemitism. Because after I went back to Greece, a lot of memories. I went to my hometown. I had 2 children in Greece. And then my husband said to me, they gave him a visa to go to America. You want to go? I told him, sell everything, let's go. We used to have a happy life. Very comfortable life. Very, very comfortable life I had in Greece after I was married. But I don't care. No future. 5 families in drama was Jewish. We have a Sefer Torah. We used to have services in one house, which everybody left. Now nobody's over there. Maybe 2 Jewish people, they live in drama. Nobody lives no more over there. And we sold the business, sold everything, and we came to the United States.